I'm Mike McMullen, president of the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce. I want to welcome you to the annual tradition of our State of the County Address, where we hear from all five of our commissioners. COVID-19 has really done a number to us. Normally, we would be at the Carroll Arts Center with about 200 folks applauding their every word. Right now, we're all here in this room, and there aren't that many of us, but there's you at home that are going to get to watch this and those that watch this after the fact. We're going to get through COVID-19 together. There's no question about it. We've survived so many things. The chamber's been around since 1924. So I like to tell people we made it through the Great Depression, World War II, all the other wars. We're going to make it through this as well. But we're going to do it together. So the message that I send out all the time is, what's happened now is small businesses have been hurt, restaurants have been hurt, and it's pushed us into the arms of Amazon. And everybody uses Amazon. I use it once in a while. But we have to keep in mind the small business community. They are the ones that we rely on to pay taxes, to give to the different nonprofits in the area, and to keep folks employed here. So whenever you can, spend your money local. You can go to our website, carrollcountychamber.org. We have about 625 different actual members. And these folks need your help. And if you want some of these little restaurants that you love to be there after the fact, go buy gift cards now. Get some actual carryout. Do whatever you can. So as the norm, normally what we would do is bring up, and we're going to bring up now, our current chair of the board and thank him for serving during a very difficult year, and that is Mr. Dennis Twigg. Dennis, come on up. Dennis, as he walks up around, I have a plaque to give to him as a thank you for all that he's done for us. A very nice plaque. Mr. Dennis, come up here. Thank you, sir. Dennis Twigg, chair of the board. Give me a little fist pump, and I turn him over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you all for attending in whatever capacity you're able to attend today. Before I accepted being chair of the board, I actually talked to a number of past chairs, including Steve Aquino, who's going to be the current chair in about 10 minutes. He did his best to tell me what to expect about serving in this role, and we talked about the extra work, extra meetings, and going to live events. And Steve, you didn't do quite a great job preparing for this year because you didn't predict COVID. But that being said, we adapted, and we at the Chamber have done our best to pivot into a digital space to be there for our business community and our constituency to whatever extent that we can be. We've expanded our staff, and I think that between Mike and Peggy and Becky, they've done a great job being a great resource for this community and its membership. I'd like to thank all the people who stuck with us and all the people that have participated in the chamber in this year. I'll always remember it for being the chair, but also by the different capacity in which we all participated. And it has been a great honor and privilege to serve as a chair in this most unusual of years. I'd also like to thank M&T Bank for sponsoring this event. And I'd like to introduce Mark Blackston to talk a few minutes about the bank. Mark, come on up. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for the kind introduction, Dennis. And on behalf of M&T Bank and my Carroll County colleagues, I sincerely appreciate the opportunity to again sponsor today's State of the County Address, which obviously we said is a little bit different, but really doesn't change the great messaging that we all hear and enjoy from many years past that we've gathered together. As Dennis said, my name is Mark Blackson. I'm an administrative vice president and proudly lead the business banking team of professionals that are 100% focused on small business, their owners, and employees. As many said, 2020 was an extraordinary year for all of us. We've all had to find ways to work differently, to learn differently, and to family differently. And while we are all continuing to adjust to this new normal, so many others have continued to keep the engine running, and especially our front lines. And I would be remiss if I didn't take the opportunity here to seize the moment and thank, and they can't be thanked enough, quite frankly, the members of our medical community, our first responders, our military, our teachers, our grocery and food service workers, and many, many others that have kept our country running since early 2020. But what about small businesses? Mike mentioned them earlier. Our small business community and the employees and families that these important businesses serve continue to be impacted by these unprecedented times. But there have been many bright spots. A particular note was the passing of the CARES Act, which provided needed resources in the form of EIDL loans and paycheck protection loans and put dollars into the hands of these much needed businesses. Back in April, M&T Bank was one of 5,400 bank and non-bank institutions that stepped up to assist qualified business to put through forgivable capital in the form of PPP loans. According to recent SBA data, banks facilitated PPP loans to over 5.2 million businesses, totaling over $525 billion. For M&T's part, my colleagues and I were proud to be a top 10 provider of PPP funding in the U.S. I know from firsthand experience, our local M&T team worked day and night during that time to continue to process PPP applications for our valued clients. We assisted over 35,000 businesses at M&T, so many right here in Carroll County, with over $7 billion, and that directly impacted 765,000 employees. But our work is not over, and it's not even close. Since early September, M&T and my colleagues have been working closely with these businesses to help work through the next phase, which has been forgiveness. So we're processing a lot of those applications as we speak. So where are we today? As many of you have heard, Congress recently passed the Economic Aid Act, earmarking an additional $284 billion for PPP loans to further support the hardest hit smallest businesses, nonprofits, venues that continue to struggle in the current pandemic. M&T continues to stand ready. We're hoping to open our portal very soon. The SBA actually authorized small lenders to open up yesterday. So there are some out there that are already accepting, but M&T will be ready to do that very shortly. As we approach the end of the year, or actually the beginning of the year, we're continuing to be here to serve. So with that, I'll say thank you again for the opportunity to sponsor this annual update, wishing each of you a very happy, healthy, and hopefully even a fun-filled new year. And I wouldn't be able to end this without saying go Ravens. So wishing them the best of luck as they head into their playoff game this weekend. Thank you very much, and thanks to the Chamber. And Dennis, I'll turn it back to you.
Thank you, Mark. It's my pleasure to call up the once and future chair of the board, Steve Aquino. There you go.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dennis. I appreciate it. It truly is an honor to be serving again this year as the chairman of the board of the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce. Again, I'm Steve Aquino. I'm a small business owner. I have a little wealth management independent financial planning firm right here in Westminster, Aquino Financial Group. I've been a member of the chamber for many years. Probably going back to the early 2000s, and I joined the board shortly after that. You know, it's been an amazing ride, and it's amazing to be here 10 years later. I remember sitting back on the stage at the Arts Center the first time going back there 10 years ago. Mike McMullen was coming to his first year. You know, that year we had many challenges going in. We only had about 400 and something members that were members of the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce, and we had a whole new way of doing things. Mike did a fantastic job, and I thank Mike for all the hard work that you've done to be able to grow to our membership where it is today of over 600 members. Now, it's very important to look at it from a perspective of, you know, what the membership does, you know, what we do for the membership and the different benefits that we provide. You know, we had great leadership over those years to get us to that point, you know, with you know, before last year with Dennis as you know, coming into a very unusual time. So again, 10 years later, now we're going to be dealing with another unusual times of how we're going to be able to provide benefits. I'm actually excited about this year coming forward. You know, we're taking unique stances and unique ways of providing, you know, those different benefits, whether if it's promoting your business, helping small businesses, shopping local, and all those types of things. You know, the chamber, you know, comes together, you know, for the community. We help each other, and it's very important that we continue to do that through the different leadership programs that we provide, the different types of things that we do for the community, acknowledgements, different types of recognitions for what we do as a whole, as a community, and also for our member benefits. So, you know, we have to keep continuing to do that. I'm excited to be a part of that and, you know, being able to, you know, continue what we've done, make the changes that we need to make. But, you know, one thing you have to always remember is, you know, to shop local, you know, to help those businesses that are really hurting bad. You know, and I think that, you know, by doing that, we'll be able to grow as a community, grow as membership, and continue to, you know, be able to provide back to the community. You know, there's a lot that we can be able to give back, especially our nonprofit members. You know, so if you know people that are out there that aren't members of the chamber, please reach out to Mike, reach out to Peggy, reach out to Becky, see what those benefits are, how we can help you through these hard times. You know, if you're, you know somebody who's not a member, you know, give them the information, get them to get a hold of Mike also, you know, as we go through it, because we're not a part of any kind of national chamber. We're not part of any kind of state chamber. We're a local here for the community and for our local small businesses and the businesses that are around us. So I'm very excited, you know, of what's going to be happening this year. You know, again, it's an honor and privilege to be serving again 10 years later. You know, we got a lot of new things that are going on. So please keep an eye for all the notifications that, you know, that Mike's sending out, or you know, Peggy or Becky, of the different events that we do, whether if it's on Zoom. You know, hopefully we're going to get back to doing things live, but we're still going forward. We're still providing all the same kind of great benefits to all of our members. So with that being said, thank you so much. I'm excited about this year, and now it's time to be able to introduce the president of the board of the commissioners, Commissioner Ed Rothstein, to begin the 2021 State of the County address. Thank you very much.
I appreciate that applause. Mike, thank you once again for all that you're doing for the chamber. And Dennis, again, great messages. Mark, thanks for the sponsorship. And M&T supporting our great community. Steve, congratulations once again. Before I start, I just want to share that let's continue to have our thoughts and prayers for those that are challenged through this pandemic, and give them strength, give their families and friends strength and courage as they're fighting through some of the difficult times that are with them today and lie in front of us. I'm going to try and do some of this without my glasses, but no matter how big this font is, I think I'm going to still need these glasses over the next couple minutes. But good morning. It's an honor and privilege to kick off this year's Carroll County State of the County Address. The venue may have changed, but the intent remains the same: to provide you with our candid thoughts and insight on how we see the state of the county and community, while being transparent, open, and honest with all that we do. After my comments, we will be in the order of districts 4, 3, 2, and 1, with our past president, Commissioner Wance, as our cleanup. Recently, a co-worker and mentor of mine, whether she knows that last bit or not, shared with me that she starts every year with a resolution by choosing a word. Now, some of those words may be hope, joy, praise. I thought about this, And I said, what should my word be for this year? And it's citizenship. And it's not necessarily citizenship on what I do, but it's leading through citizenship. It's sharing the importance of citizenship. It's communicating everything we do on making Carroll County stronger through citizenship. You've heard me say before, I use the listen, learn, lead approach. And it's time to lead and lead with citizenship and share that the best I can. Our county is in challenging times and faces more challenges ahead, but I'm absolutely certain that our Carroll Countyans are resilient, and I have unwavering confidence that we will get through this together. To use an analogy of a bookshelf, and you got to picture this with bookshelf and bookends on each side and a whole bunch of books. On the one side, 2020, those books are vertical. We started off very strong. We were well, we were employed, we were prosperous. Things were going very well. Well, then there's this pandemic hit, and some of those books fell down in the middle. And those books falling down in the middle was over those last 9 months. That's life. That's some of our own choices, but it's also what the pandemic has hit us with. I'm absolutely convinced that by pushing the bookends back together, we will get those books back to vertical. In my honest opinion, the state of the county has a few books, as I shared, that have fallen by the side. So specifically, those books include our personal health, our employment, schools, businesses, restaurants, etc. Therefore, for me to say that the state of the county and stand here and tell you that the state of the county is currently strong would be misleading. With that said, I believe that Carroll Countyans are extremely resilient, and that by working together, neighbor to neighbor, these books will become vertical once again. We will be successful through county citizenship between our partnerships with government, local, state, and federal, with a huge shout out to Ed Singer and his health department team and all they're doing in keeping us safe. Our businesses, our schools, and most of all you, our community, who we serve. We will have a strong state of the county once again. Between now and then, we must navigate through some of these turbulent waters that focus on our health, personal, and economic well-being. An example of leading through these waters has been the decision-making process and execution of the federal, state, and county funds. Federal funds, including the CARES Act, gave us about $29 million that went to our health department and to our county government in response to the COVID-19 pandemic. The county and, $1.2 million from the state most recently went to our local restaurants, and additional funds are going to our hotels and motels to support those six inside the county. But what I'm most proud of is in Carroll County, our economic development team, in early March, April, before state and federal funds became available, acted on the needs that small businesses and our restaurants in our community were going through. And these funds were very quick to turn around from acceptance to execution. And they made a difference in the small businesses and restaurants. But what's going to make the biggest difference, and what's shared from Mike McMullen and the others, is your community by shopping and eating local and continuing to shop and eat local. As Commissioner Wance has said a few times, I ask that we continue to focus our efforts on Main Street and not necessarily Wall Street. Also, with that said, I would be remiss if I did not reflect on some of the successes that also occurred during 2020. That does have the 2021 books on the shelf starting out vertically. Early during the pandemic, neighbors in our community struggled with unemployment as it skyrocketed. Working with our delegation and administration was critical for support and communications to those going through these challenges. Also, in partnership with Howard County, we identified a way to support those in need with a pragmatic approach that included multiple pop-up pantries. We were able to feed hundreds every weekend throughout Carroll County and established a community organization, Active in Disasters, or COAD, in South Carroll County. Also, we work closely with the community in partnership with the Planning Commission and our government team in preparation to make our final decisions in rezoning when it comes to commercial, industrial, and the employment campuses. This could never have been done without you and our community's commitment. Another highlight is successfully maintaining our AAA bond rating, which allows us to keep our county fiscally strong for appropriate lending and investments that focus on our county needs. We ended the census count being number one once again in Maryland and ranked 24th in the entire country. Through partnership with CC Visa and others, we established for the first time, and you can hear more about this, in our county, the Department of Fire and EMS. We conducted the groundbreaking of our Carroll County Career and Tech Center, just to name a few of the highlights from 2020. Lastly, I'd be remiss if I didn't show appreciation to our entire Carroll County team. Their selflessness, integrity, and commitment to our community is second to none. With that said, a specific and well-deserved shout out goes to my colleague, my friend, and past president of our board, Commissioner Steve Wance. Steve's commitment over the past 2 years are second to none. His leadership is most highlighted during the past year, during these very challenging times in a continued state of emergency. Steve has been consistent in keeping Carroll Countyans first and foremost on his mind when making decisions and directions, both internally and externally. I'd like to say that the past year has made his hair turn gray, but unfortunately you need some of that hair to make that observation of value. Well, we will accomplish our priorities within Carroll County that include having a budget that supports our community, balancing our beautiful agricultural culture and economic business and growth where it makes sense, and keeping safe and secure environment for all of us to be proud of. These accomplishments may not all come easy, but I am confident that they are all obtainable. In closing, just as I started 2021 focusing on the word citizenship, I challenge all of you to come up for a word of the year. And then also looking at what the county word may be, and I came up with courage. Courage and focusing on having the courage to doing what's right, even when no one is looking. Courage not to give in to defeatist rhetoric or social media conspiracy theories. Courage to act, getting through these incredibly challenging times for yourself, your family, our friends, and community. And courage in partnership at all times between all of us to strengthen the county. Although the waters may be turbulent, I am confident once again through our collective courage, we all sail through them in prosperity and success. I am proud, as always, to be a Carroll Countyan, a Marylander, and an American. In closing, life is always good. And as I shared, we'll be now followed by districts 4, and then 3, 2, and then Commissioner Wentz, our past president, will be cleanup in district 1. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you, President Rothstein. Good morning, Mr. McMillan, Carroll County, and my colleagues. My subject is financial uncertainty caused by the pandemic. As a business owner, like many others throughout the county, the burden to stay open and carry employees on payroll weighs heavy upon not only the resources, but also the mind. Individuals throughout the county are struggling to adjust and juggle their modified or lost employment, kids' educational demands as crash course teachers, and cope with the emotional psychological trauma of all this uncertainty. Every business owner of a heart and love for their employees' well-being has endured many sleepless nights, tossing restlessly, praying for a break in the clouds to shine upon their financial survival. For they do not exist just to turn a profit, but also the means for employees to pay mortgages, rent, feed their children, and ultimately enjoy the American dream of independence and fiscal security. Every holiday season, Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol plays on TV in numerous variations, from the classic productions to Mr. Magoo and even Bill Murray's Scrooge. I try to watch them all, so the message of love and compassion for everyone's fellow man maintains an indelible imprint upon my consciousness throughout the year. This past December, the message was more pertinent than ever before with the surging virus infections, fatalities, lost employment, and educational crisis we all collectively brave. Contrary to what some of our critics think, We, the Board of Commissioners, are not cold and personal beings. We are parents, grandparents, friends, neighbors, and employers like the constituents we were elected to represent. Therefore, we withstand sleepless nights wondering how we are going to administer and finance EMS, public safety, education, solid waste, and even things most people don't even consider, like ensuring that old deteriorating bridges do not collapse due to their projected life cycles being exceeded. With that preface, I will address the subject matter of fiscal uncertainty. Our county budget is structurally out of balance in out years for a long list of reasons, from the individuals you elect to unfunded federal and state mandates we locally have no control of, but must find ways to finance at the detriment of basic needs like public safety and road maintenance. It was tough before COVID hit and the policies thereof have crippled our local economy. Now we debate and haggle over how to pay deputies and bus drivers with minimum wage increases causing wage compression throughout the entire payroll system and maintaining buildings from deteriorating. As this staff knows, I've been on building roofs and fleet maintenance garages under bridges and even hiking through the parks, reviewing projects, trying to see the perspective of our staff, which has been entrusted to execute for the public good. Therefore, I can tell you our county employees are top-notch, conscientious public servants committed to their duties. We do not run a top-heavy bureaucracy living large on the backs of hardworking taxpayers in Carroll County. Our local economy has stayed afloat due to the federal government borrowing money on the international bond market, which devalues the dollar and reduces available funding in subsequent budgets due to debt payments exponentially consuming discretionary spending. In individual terms, it is the equivalent to taking a very large mortgage and having less money to buy food, clothing, etc. This has been the practice to saddle our public with an ever-growing percentage of long-term debt financing projects constituents demand, not knowing, understanding, or even caring about the ramifications upon the future. All too often, politicians lose courage and capitulate to the pressures for numerous reasons: lack of long-term fiscal knowledge, wanting to be liked, and even, imagine this, desire to win an election. Folks, the allegedly free money is going to run out, and only hopes for our fiscal salvation lies in allowing a private sector free market to thrive. As an admirer of the great Alexander Hamilton, who, by the way, was not a rapping stage actor, I know that what recuperated our infant nation from the destitute of Revolutionary War debt and fiscal chaos: a free, thriving business community where individuals keep more of their own money to invest, save, and buy, not more debt, more taxation, and more regulations. Therefore, it is distressing when government officials, both elected, appointed, or hired, continue to serve up the antithesis of a cure, only to perpetuate the misery and distress upon future generations. At present, our administration is facing the following responsibilities without any known revenue to surmount: the EMS takeover of 150 employees, deputies, teachers, staff leaving due to lack of pay, failing infrastructure, Kerwin mandates, stormwater management, law enforcement body cams, wage compression due to state mandates, 911 expansion, solid waste recycling mandates, post-employment liabilities, and demands for more buildings such as senior centers and the South Carroll precinct. You as citizens do not have the ability, and neither should you, to just go take money from your neighbor because you don't have the income to build a shed, remodel the kitchen, or pave the driveway. However, all too often, this is what your government does to you. Our local government is faced with the increasing pressure from those receiving public payroll to raise taxes. They want an EMS tax, a law enforcement tax, an educational tax, and now the new word game of systems benefit tax. I sympathize with all those who need more pay, especially considering what is forthcoming economically, and that is inflation caused by the expansion of federal debt via stimulus checks. Mark my words and note them. The policies that have kept us afloat could possibly sink us in the future with inflation. To all those calling for tax increases, it is too simplistic and ignorant of a solution void of economic intellect concerning free markets our nation was founded upon. Be forewarned, even if we raise all those taxes to cover the shortfalls beating at our door, we will just be in the red again due to the leaders in Annapolis and Washington who, without delay, pass more unfunded mandates on the local jurisdictions to budget. It's a vicious cycle driven by politicians at all levels. Now you must ask, what is the solution? One, on the long term, stop electing so many government employees to be in charge of public finances. Putting the fox in charge of guarding the hen house results in less chickens. Elect more private sector representatives from the business community. Two, freeze all capital building projects that we legally can, such as the South Carroll Precinct. Three, freeze all ag preservation, which is clearly farmer welfare subsidies. Ag preservation usurps funding of public safety and handicaps commercial industrial development severely lacking in the county. We have hobbled our property tax base with land that generates minimum tax. Fourth, link the solid waste and recycling costs, which fluctuates with market forces, directly to haulers and users and fees, and not the ineptitude of creating a systems benefit tax, have an absolutely zero tethering to the cause of why solid waste is sinking into the red each subsequent year of the budget forecast. Fifth, find ways to delay and or modify implementation of stamp mandates through legal research and consideration of the present state of emergency. In closing, Lord be with us all as we enter the next crisis of this pandemic, the fiscal aftermath and recovery of the process. Thank you very much and God bless.
Thank you, Commissioner Boucher. I'm going to apologize for having to hold this up and read it, but even with the glasses, I can't put it here and see it. I just the way it is. I feel sorry for Weaver. I'd like to thank everyone for listening today, even if it is just virtual. However, it is the safest way to accomplish this mission today. I want to start by thanking our county workers. They have done a fantastic job throughout this pandemic. The county office building was closed for a while. People have had to work from home. Others would need to come in because of the nature of their jobs. COVID protocols were established and followed, and even physical barriers have been installed. Throughout it all, the level of service to the public has been exemplary. The balancing act has been achieved between service and safety. The county's Economic Development Department has also managed millions of dollars in grants to our businesses and restaurants, and had the money into the hands of businesses before other counties even started looking at applications. On a side note, I know there have been a few glitches in the mail delivery and some checks were slowed down. That is not Carroll County's fault. Carroll County has done a great job from audio video production to public works to technology services and all the departments in between. Every employee has done what it was needed to make it work, and I thank you for that. Now on to something that has not gone so well, how the Board of Education has handled the pandemic. First, let me state that they are a separately elected board and make the decisions on how to run Carroll County Public Schools. But that does not mean that I, as a county commissioner, should sit idly by when I believe the safety of the county has been put in jeopardy. I don't understand how they can go against the advice of the health officer and put children back in school during what is so far the height of the pandemic. But perhaps worst, well, maybe just as equally as bad, is they have not even followed their own motions. In the December meeting, they voted to resume hybrid learning on January 7th, only if the metrics improved. That vote didn't seem to matter in the January 4th meeting when the motion was made to go back to hybrid, because not only had the metrics not improved, but have gotten much worse. And still they voted to send children back. And I do thank Dr. Dorsey for a vote against it. As I stated, and Dr. Lockhart's comments seem to agree, that perhaps waiting about 2 weeks to see if the numbers would peak and even start going down before sending children back into the building might have been a prudent decision. The Board of Education seems to be hanging their hat on the facts that most people in the hospital from COVID are now in the over 40 age group, and most deaths are in the over 65 age group. But this is the pandemic. The concern is not just about the number of children who may contract the virus and their ill effects, although that is a major concern, but also about the children who may contract the virus, be asymptomatic as many people are, and bring the virus home to their families and continue to spread. Additionally, some of those family members may be in the over 40 age groups. That in turn would send more people into an already stressed hospital system and possibly cause more deaths. This is a pandemic. We must think about our community when making decisions and not just about one segment of it. Now, changing gears, I'll move on to mass transit. Did you get that? Now, since I've been a county commissioner, the most common thing I've heard about the Carroll County's mass transit system is that the wait time for too long to make it convenient to use. Well, actually, the most common thing I've heard about our mass transit system is Carroll County has a mass transit system? We do. But getting back to wait times. When I started on the Transit Advisory Council, wait times are well over an hour, and depending on what route and time of day, maybe even closer to 2 hours. But by better utilizing the buses we have and changing some routes, the wait time for almost all stops will be cut down to 30 minutes. You can't really expect better than that for mass transit. And because we're using the hub and spoke system, at least that's what I'm calling it, you can take a bus from anywhere we provide service to anywhere else in the county that we provide service, because all passengers can be taken from the Burke Center, which is our hub, and get on another bus to go anywhere else in the county you want. You have to check our website or call the county for the exact information. Speaking of our website, if you haven't visited it lately, you should. It's much easier to navigate and find out what you're looking for. When we were in the process of the redesign, I said, we need a website that someone with little or no computer knowledge could use, and I can. So it passed the test. In closing, I want to thank the Chamber for hosting the State of the County again, even under these circumstances, and for everyone for listening. Stay safe, wear a mask, and now we go on to everyone's second favorite commissioner, Commissioner Weaver.
Thank you, Dennis. On a more optimistic note, when I delivered my State of the County address, I chose to focus on technological advances coming into the agriculture over the next decade. I remain very optimistic about the agricultural and small business future in Carroll County. 2020 has been extremely difficult for agriculture and local businesses and restaurants. They've had to endure substantial setbacks to their financial stability and to endure in their future growth. As a county, our economic development team, under the direction of Jack Lyburn, has done a terrific job of dispersing millions of dollars of CARES funding to those businesses. While I will discuss this will be discussed in more detail by my colleagues, I would like to continue to implore Carroll County community to continue the commitment to investment and support of local small businesses and entrepreneurs. I want to get back to the agriculture industry a moment. It's a sometimes forgotten about small business and has always operated with an incredibly narrow margin for success. Those in the agricultural community are always at the mercy of fluctuating markets, unpredictable weather, and continuously evolving supply and demand problems. This year, we briefly experienced shortages in our food supply due to the interruptions in the food chains. While this was short-lived, we must heed the warning and realize the frailty of this system that brings food from farm to our tables. What might our lives look like with shortages for weeks and months? The realities that COVID, extreme weather patterns, and growing populations have shown cannot be ignored. Locally, a lot of small farms, agricultural businesses, butcher shops accepted this challenge and pushed their capacity to keep the local food chain flowing. When we were in this difficult situation, the local agricultural community answered the call. This is why I continue to be a strong proponent of agriculture land preservation. If we get to our goal of preserving 100,000 acres or one-third of the county, we would continue to invest in the security and sustainability of our local food chain. This goal is the only county goal set that has been passed on to every administration since 1980. This year, we have over 75,000 acres preserved and look forward to celebrating that milestone once this pandemic subsides. We started with 250,000 acres to preserve 75,000 acres. We were down to 45,000 acres today to preserve 25,000. The ratio is much smaller as demand is placed on the remaining 45,000 acres for development and other uses. With that, we have an initiative this year that I want to bring about, and that is the community solar zoning proposal and the concepts providing additional acres to preserved acreage. These are parcels that are remaining in agriculture areas that have already exhausted their development rights and are limited to their future zoning uses. The idea is to meet the Maryland Public Utilities Codes. And some highlights of this proposed concept are that there are 20-acre sites maximum for solar usage, and they only exist can exist in remaining portions of the date of ordinance as date of ordinance are eligible. They cannot be created or a lot or a tract for the purpose of solar development. Requires a permanent easement to be granted to the county upon installation of the solar facility. The easement establishes an additional residential and non-agricultural development area, solar panels cannot exceed 2 megawatts on the parcel, and that's 5 to 7 acres each for 1,000 megawatts. Requires Planning and Zoning Commission review and approval. And the property owner is responsible for control of noxious weeds, invasive plants, site, and prevent spread to surrounding areas of those noxious plants. And this whole concept has a lot of bulk requirements, height requirements, but the owner and operator is still responsible for the agreement with Public Works to ensure proper decommissioning of the area once the solar panels are taken away, and all responsibilities basically fall to the landowner. And finally, this morning, I want to introduce the Panther Event Center in Hampstead at the former North Carroll High School. This year, Carroll County entered into an agreement with the Chesapeake Real Estate Group to purchase the school and develop the Panther Event Center. This facility will include turf and grass fields, as well as gymnasiums and an athletic center. Our goal was to ensure the building and property would continue to be a staple of the community and an asset to the entire region. Additionally, the auditorium, with its 900-seat capacity, will continue to be utilized and provide the county with a venue for shows, performances, and a variety of other entertainment opportunities. I want to thank the town of Hampstead and the Manchester Valley Athletic Boosters, especially Matt Collender, for their help and support in getting this agreement put together. Presently, it's only an agreement, but I'm very confident we will be continuing along these lines. As we all sit here this morning, 2020 has defined by hardships and barriers it placed in front of us all. However, I firmly believe history will remember 2020 as a catalyst that highlights our steadfast resolve and dedication to one another. As always, it has been an honor and privilege to serve as the Carroll County Commissioner representing District 2. And now I'd like to introduce a good friend of mine, a person who served as president of the board throughout the past 2 years. He's undedicated service to Carroll County, Commissioner Steve Wance.
Thank you, Commissioner Weaver. Good morning and Happy New Year to all. It remains my honor to address our citizens and business community with the annual State of the County Address. You've already heard this, but again, thank you to the Chamber of Commerce for always making this event a success. The voyage to this year's State of the County has been long and treacherous, one in which none of us expected. My message last year was one of exuberance. I talked of education, economics, and emergency services, the core of decision-making for local government. I equated leadership during this pandemic to sailing a ship. The sea was calm, and our journey mapped with minor blips on the radar. We were experiencing revenue growth, low unemployment, and the horizon was clear. Our sails were unfurled and open to the winds of success. And then the Ides of March, and the seas became rough. On March 13th, 2020, our radar gave a strong warning signal, and all normalcy stopped. We were now in dangerous seas in an ever-changing, unrecognizable environment. We switched to response to the COVID pandemic, recovery of our economy, and the tremendous effort of keeping our citizens safe. States of emergency were declared, and the entire nation changed course. There was no playbook for this undertaking, but we immediately jumped into action. The impact to date, 2.3 million Americans infected. It's taken the lives of over 28,000. In Carroll, over 5,600 cases, and now over 192 deaths. As the 2020 president of the board, with the help of my colleagues, we declared war on this pandemic. I want to thank them for their support in some very difficult decisions. And Commissioner Rothstein, I want to thank you specifically for your kind words this morning. Our focused and consistent message rang loud and clear, and together with our partners, the collaboration has been effective. Carroll County government never wavered, continuing to provide resources necessary for all of our citizens. Our health department engaged and continues to lead the charge. I've talked with our health officer, Ed Singer, many times daily in the last year, often at very interesting hours of the day. To Ed Singer and the president of Carroll Hospital Center, Garrett Hoover, and LifeBridge Health Vice President Leslie Simmons, thank you. Nurses, doctors, our first responders, including fire, emergency medical, law enforcement, emergency management, our dispatchers, our Department of Public Works, all of our county employees, those who clean and maintain our buildings, our Chamber of Commerce, our businesses, and our eight great municipalities, and a large majority of our citizens, we are all engaged to ensure we weather this storm. Carroll was one of the first jurisdictions to provide relief funding for our businesses, using funding we had set aside for other economic projects. We stood with Governor Hogan and his team to provide consistency, and with press conferences, town hall meetings, some of them right here, and constant flow of messaging through our website and other social media, we continue to be extremely transparent. We used social media in a professional manner, not going down that rabbit hole of the disturbing negative social media trends. Still, mask wearing, social distancing, and hand washing became political statements, and opinions threatened our journey, and some decisions, dialogue, and conduct made us shake our heads. But we, as your county commissioners, have persevered. We paid attention to the health experts and continue to work hand in hand as the light at the end of this journey grows brighter. As we begin 2021, vaccines are being given. Our citizens remain vigilant with best practices, and it is imperative we continue the fight. With current numbers, we may well be in the worst spot we have been in with this pandemic. Last week, Carroll saw a record number of new cases at 468. Community spread remains on the rise, and I remain challenged by the decision to reopen schools for in-person learning against the advice of the Health Department and the Maryland State Department of Education metrics. During this high time of high community spread and post-holiday surge, with unvaccinated teachers and staff potentially taxing our resources, we have asked for flexibility in vaccinating so that our valuable school employees are vaccinating right after vaccinated right after healthcare and first responders. This pandemic continues to wreak havoc on our economy, businesses, and families. The very fact that we are coming to you in this format today is the proof that we are not done. Yesterday, we were advised of new federal and state relief funding. Our medical folks have efficient testing and vaccine procedures, and we are all doing what we can to address the needs of our county. We can't stop or let our guard down now. Even in turmoil, there were bright spots. You heard about our successful AAA bond rating. We have the lowest unemployment rate in the state, 4.4%, and we rapidly moved to all things virtual. And we're becoming quite savvy. Government buildings received safety enhancements, and we ensured access to all departments for our citizens. We are all engaged regionally in boards and commissions. Commissioner Frazier's at the National Association of Counties. Both he and I are at the Maryland Association of Counties. Commissioner Rothstein is all over the map with regional committees. I continue to serve on the board of directors and legislative committees at MACO. For tomorrow's start of a challenging legislative session, over 900 bills have been pre-filed. Increased education funding in the form of the Kerwin bill, which Governor Hogan thankfully vetoed, will emerge again, and we must remain vigilant to the General Assembly's agenda, as this could be very detrimental to our fiscal responsibilities here. Governor Hogan announced his Relief Act of 2021 yesterday as emergency legislation, and we are hoping the legislators refocus on this rather than their personal agenda spending. And I will become chair of the Baltimore Metropolitan Council later this week, working collaboratively on issues with leaders in Baltimore City and surrounding jurisdictions. Let's be clear, what is happening in Baltimore City affects us all. Mike, I'm soon done. I know you're going to appreciate that. The safety of our citizens remains my number one priority. With 44 years of public safety experience, I know elected officials must ensure our citizens can live, work, and play safely. We continue to work closely with and support our primary law enforcement agency, the Sheriff's Department, to ensure they have the tools needed, providing state-of-the-art equipment and upgrades, and ensuring we address the many police reform bills that are coming down the pike. We have hired our first Director of Fire and Emergency Services. Director Robert McCoy has hit the ground running. The Carroll County Volunteer Emergency Services Association approached us a few years back, requesting much needed assistance. While our volunteer fire departments and personnel will be always a strong part of this county, it remains difficult to find folks who want to run into danger while everybody's running out for free. The infusion of paid career personnel into our volunteer stations is crucial, and our new director is addressing this important need. This is a large fiscal challenge, but an important mission for the future. We continue to work on funding for our 911 center from the state, and we must continue to do that as well. We cannot let our guard down when it comes to public safety. Have you seen the troubling and difficult times we are living in? How fitting is it that Saturday was National Law Enforcement Appreciation Day? I encourage each and every one of you to appreciate public safety every day. The pandemic, responsible for virtual learning and working from home, highlights the critical need of connecting through rural broadband. My district is especially challenged, and it remains unacceptable to me that in 2021, there are those with no connectivity. This is quite a task, since internet service providers are for profit and density plays a huge part in their decisions. But we are working to realize federal and state grant opportunities and continue our efforts to ensure we light up our most rural areas. Finally, we continue to build upon our solid foundation with the building blocks here of fiscal responsibility, accountability, collaboration, and transparency. Even in these challenging times, Carroll remains solid, preserving our heritage and serving its citizens well. Elected officials must make decisions needed to represent the whole of our community, not the loudest voices. A quote from Abraham Lincoln that always sticks with me. I have simply tried to do what seemed best each day as each day came. I will continue to work hard every day for this county and state that I love. God bless everyone. Please stay safe. And God bless Carroll County. And by the way, if you want a break from all this, there is something going on Saturday night that Mark talked about from M&T, and today I proudly wear the purple. With that, I turn it over to my friend and colleague, Commissioner Ed Rothstein. Thank you.
Absolutely. Go Ravens. And before I turn this over to Mike in closing, just want to share, we've heard some redundancy in comments that all five of us have made, that we are in definitely challenging times, that we are committed and supported to you, the community, and we're always, always available to you. Once again, as I shared, I believe earlier, let's keep strength and courage to you, your family, friends, neighbors, and our community as we're going through these challenging times. And now I think, and I appreciate the dead man's quote. That's, we didn't have a dead man's quote until then, so I appreciate that, Steve. So you always need that. Now, and finally, Mr. Mike McMullen, why don't you come on up here and close us out for this morning. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, commissioners. First off, I want to thank our past chair of the board, Dennis Twigg, and our current chair of the board, Steve Aquino, for being here, and our sponsor, M&T Bank. I think they said they've sponsored this event for like 13 straight years, so that's great. But mostly, I think today, I just want to thank our commissioners. Every time I sit and I listen to you guys, I think I would never want your job because it's not like you do the job for all the accolades that you get, because they're few. I've learned in my life that people, when things go well, seldom thank you, seldom say good job, seldom say we're happy. But human nature being what it is, and it's a sad thing, but I think it's true, things go the way they don't like, they're gonna let you know. You guys, I don't think I could do the job. You know, it seems like no matter what you decide, you've got critics out there. We all do. But you guys are in that line of fire where you're gonna hear from them more. So I wanna thank you for having thick skin, hopefully most of the time, and knowing that most of us really do appreciate your hard work and know you guys are working hard together. I think this is the third set of commissioners I've had the chance to work with, and I think you guys are amazing. You know, everything that you decide, is it great? Probably not. Maybe there could be better ways, but you guys care, except for you. If folks at home could see you guys making your faces at me, that'd be good. But I just want to thank you guys. I think you guys are great. And I also want to encourage everybody out there. Nowadays, social media makes it so easy to be nasty, meaning either on a big stage or on a small stage. And I would just say right now, we need to be kind to one another. We need to go easy on one another. You don't know what somebody's going through with this whole COVID thing right now. You know, they could have like a mom or a dad on the verge of death. And you don't know that because they're not going to come up and say, hey, guess what horrible things are happening to me today. Be kind to one another. It's the way to go. I mean, there's very little we can do about the main stage, what we can change, but we can change little things. Shopping local, helping out those people, being nice to one another. I want to let you know, if you've now tuned in late, this will be on our website, and I'm assuming on the actual government website. So for our upcoming events, which we have some great ones, they're going to be virtual. We are going to have some live ones later in the year. You want to go to carrollcountychamber.org, and that's where you can find all of our members any of the past events that we've done will also be there. So you can check that out there. You can also call us at 410-848-9050. Or if you happen to be strolling around beautiful downtown Westminster, we're right at 9 East Main Street. So you can stop off and say hi. So I just want to thank you all for watching today. Thank our commissioners once again and say have a wonderful day. Have a happy 2021. Stay safe and God bless. Thank you. Who could have possibly imagined what a year we had in store for us? COVID-19, small business community, hurting, but in spite of it all, we stayed together, we worked together, we fought this thing together. Let's take a look back at what life looks like and looked like with the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce.
It is our honor to again be up here on this stage to address you, our citizens, and the business community with our annual State of the County address.
And we're open.
I'm Katie Kirby from Together We Own It, and we're open.
I'm Bob Coffey from Coffee Music, and we are open.
Carroll Corona Carry Out.
There's a light at the end of the tunnel, and it'll be quite bright. You know, we're going to come out of this better than most nations.
There's never been a more appropriate time to recognize the selfless contributions of our public safety professionals.
I'm very happy to present this to Willett Family Farms.